It's lovely to have you with us again on Glad Tidings Hour. As always, we have a variety of singers and a message from God's Word. But instead of a missionary this week, we have a special slot for the young people who join us week by week on our program. This is by popular request. Again, thank you to all who send us messages, telling us which part of the service you specially enjoy and how God has spoken to you. These messages are very encouraging to us. And today now, our first item is a medley of well-known choruses by Peter Jackson and friends. And they are going to be singing for us a number of songs that you will remember perhaps from childhood days. Everybody ought to love him. Everybody ought to know. Everybody should know. And the fourth one is For God So Loved the World. So, the track title is Good News for Everyone. Sing along with them if you know the words.
Salvation, condemnation, he did
Well, that's absolutely true. And that's why Glad Tidings Hour is in existence, so that as many people as possible can get to know the message and hear the message of a free and a full salvation. And we are excited to be able to share with you wherever you are in the world. And we rejoice that you have found us. And more importantly, that you come to know the Lord Jesus Christ as your own and personal Savior. Now, the next song that we want to play on our program today is by the Calvary Trio. These three young men lived in a town in our province in Northern Ireland, in the Machrafelt district, for those of you who know where that is. The song title is Saved to the Uttermost. I love that title, because Jesus is able to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. After the Calvary Trio sings this song, Yvonne, my wife, is going to introduce our guests for today.
Of the story when the thousands were fed, how he lifted the weary and raised up the dead. I could tell of the others, like the blind made to see, but I also can tell you what's happened to me. I am saved to the uttermost. I know that I am washed in the blood of the precious Lamb, through the Father, through the Son, through the Holy Ghost. I am saved to the uttermost.
Now you must be forgiven to make heaven your home. Life you're living won't do it at all.
So trust in the Savior, he'll save you today, and with blessed assurance you too can say, I'm saved to the uttermost. I know that I am washed in the blood of the precious Lamb, through the Father, through the Son, through the Holy Ghost. I'm saved to the uttermost. I'm saved to the uttermost. I know that I am washed in the blood of the precious Lamb, through the Father, through the Son, through the Holy Ghost. I'm saved to the uttermost. Through the Father, through the Son, through the Holy Ghost. I'm saved. I'm saved. I'm saved to the uttermost.
I enjoyed that. I hope you did too. Wonderful message for today. Now, my introduction today is Mildred, who's going to sing a song you probably know. Sing along with her. It is, Jesus Loves Me, This I Know, For the Bible Tells Me So. Then, our good friend Andy Lovell has one of his special Bible stories. He has brought his little friend Freddie with him to sing a song. If you would like to do my quiz on the story each week, just ask your mum or dad to send me a private message with your name and email address, and I can add you to the list of boys and girls who are answering the questions week by week. Now, Freddie, let's see you. And Andy, we're looking forward to your story.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me. He who died, heaven's gate to open wide. He will wash away my sin. Let his little child come in. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me. He will stay close beside me all the way. If I love him when I die, he will take me home. Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus, take this heart of mine, make it pure and wholly thine. Thou hast bled and died for me. I will henceforth live for thee. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. The Bible tells me so.
Well, hello, girls and boys. It's great that you could join me today. Now, here is a little song that's taken from the Bible that Freddie's going to sing after I've told you a little Bible lesson. But it says, you find these words in Ezekiel 36:26. It says, a new heart also will I give you. Well, why would you need a new heart? Well, the Bible says we're born with deceitful hearts and sinful hearts. That's why we tell lies and take things we shouldn't and look at things we shouldn't, do things we shouldn't, say things we shouldn't. But the Lord Jesus can give us a new heart, also will I give you, and a new spirit I will put within you. He puts the spirit of Christ in you. And the Bible says when Jesus comes and lives in you, then one day you can go to heaven. He says, I will take away the stony heart. That's the hard heart, that heart that rebels against God. And I will give you a heart of flesh. The Bible says he that has the Lord Jesus has life, everlasting life. Well, we'll come back to that little verse in a minute. But first of all, I want to tell you about a young man today. And he was a servant. Yeah, read about him in the Bible. But he was a servant in the house of Philemon. And his name was Onesimus. Yes, that's not a name we hear a lot today, is it? But it's a lovely name. It has a lovely meaning. Boys and girls, lots of names have meanings. Now, if your name was Ruth, it would mean faithful companion. And if your name was Andrew, it would mean strong. And if your name was Matthew, it would mean gift from God. But if your name was Onesimus, it would mean profitable. That means useful, good fella to have around. But boys and girls, sadly, Onesimus didn't live up to his name. Now, today I'm gonna give him a shorten his name, just because I'm not great with names. So instead of calling Onesimus, we're gonna call him Ness. Okay, in our story, we'll call him Ness. And I want to tell you what kind of Ness he was, because he wasn't profitable and he wasn't useful. Boys and girls, he was a bad Ness. Oh yeah, he was a bad Ness because he wouldn't do what he was told. And he was a useless Ness. Oh yeah, so come on now, Ness, oh, come on and do this. But he was a useless Ness because he was unprofitable. Yeah, and of course he told He told porcupines, he told lies. He was a deceitfulness, a deceitfulness. Boys and girls, he was always thinking of himself. That's what sin makes you do. He was a selfishness. And boys and girls, he was a laziness. Yeah, and of course, all this made him a sadness. Oh yeah, he was a sadness. Because sin doesn't bring joy, sin brings sorrow and sadness. And he was always thinking of himself. Of course, that made him a very sadness. But you know, boys and girls, one day, he did a terrible thing. I mean, he'd done a lot of bad things. He was an unprofitable servant. But one day, he stole from his master. Philemon. Now, boys and girls, in those days, they didn't have banks like we do today. So if, you know, people had something precious, they would keep it somewhere hidden, safe in the house. And Ness found out where Philemon kept his valuables. And we don't know exactly how it happened, but maybe it was early one morning before the sun had risen. He crept down the stairs. Boys and girls, he went to where Philemon kept his valuables and he stole. And of course, after he'd stole, he ran. He ran for his life, literally for his life. Because boys and girls, in Bible days, if a servant was caught stealing, he could be put to death. Well, that reminds us, boys and girls, that the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. So boys and girls, Ness ran, but he didn't run to the next village or the next town. He ran to the great big city of Rome. Oh yeah, where there was hundreds of thousands of people. He thought, no one will find me here. And he was right. He was right. When, of course, Philemon got up in the morning and realized he'd been robbed, he called all the servants together. They realized Ness was missing and they sent people to look for him, but they couldn't find him. Ness had got away with it. But boys and girls, be sure your sins will find you out. And boys and girls, Ness thought it was great. He'd stolen from his master, who's in the big city of Rome. But boys and girls, we don't know exactly what happened, what he did, but it wasn't long before he found himself in prison. In prison, yeah. Boy, he never thought he'd end up in prison. He must have done something real bad, but there he was in prison. And boy, it was terrible cold, and he slept on the stone floor, and there was thugs and murderers and muggers. Poor young Ness. He was afraid, I'm sure, and lonely, and maybe thinking, oh, I wish I'd been a good lad. But he tried so hard to do the right thing, but he just couldn't. But there in the prison, he met a lovely old man. His name was Paul. Now, Paul wasn't in prison for doing anything bad, for murdering or stealing or lying. No, Paul was in prison for telling people about Jesus. The Roman guards had put Paul in prison because he was telling everybody about God's wonderful love, how Jesus died on the cross, how he rose again, one day he's coming again. But of course, they didn't like it, so they put him in prison. But it didn't make much difference to Paul because he just told people in prison about Jesus. And he saw about the Lord Jesus, and he saw that Ness was looking sad. He said, "What's the matter with you, young man?" He said, "What's the matter with me? I'll tell you what's the matter with me. I'm just a bad Ness, a sad Ness, a lazy Ness." "Well, what you need is, you need a new heart. You need God can take away your sinful heart and give you a new heart. You see, the Lord Jesus loves you, Ness." "Hang on a minute. He couldn't love me. You don't know how bad I've been. I stole from my own master. He was so good to me as well." "Oh, I used to be worse than you," said Paul. "Oh, you couldn't have been worse than me, couldn't be?" "Well, I did. I was. I was a murderer." "What? What? You? Oh, yeah. But you're so kind and loving." "Oh, well, the Lord Jesus has changed my life. He took away my stony heart. He gave me a heart of flesh, a new heart. But I was worse than you. I was a murderer. Oh, yeah, I had people locked up and tortured until they died. I was such a wicked person. In actual fact, I was a chief, the worst sinner you could ever get." "Well, what happened?" "The Lord Jesus changed my life. One day I called upon his name and I asked him into my heart to forgive me, and he changed my life. He turned me around, Ness, and he can do it for you. If you turn from your sin, if you tell him you're sorry, if you turn from your sin, and if you repent, that's a big word, it means tell the Lord Jesus you're sorry from your sin. If you do that, Ness, and if you trust him, even though you can't see him, if you have faith, he will give you a new heart. He'll change your life. And boys and girls right there in the prison, Ness asked the Lord Jesus to come into his heart and forgive him his sin. He confessed his sin to the Lord Jesus, not to anybody, but to the Lord Jesus. And the Bible says if you do, the Lord Jesus will forgive your sin. He can do that because he died on the cross to take away our sin. And he rose again, and one day he's coming again. But boys and girls, Ness's life was changed completely. Instead of being a bad Ness, he was a good Ness. Oh yeah. Instead of being a useless Ness, he was a useful Ness. Instead of being a deceitful Ness, he became a truthful. Instead of being a selfishness, he became a kindness. Instead of being a laziness, he became a busyness. Instead of being a sadness, you've got it, he became a happiness. Hallelujah. He became a happiness because the Lord Jesus had taken away that stony heart and given a heart, a new heart. The Bible calls it a heart of flesh. And boys and girls today, if you receive Jesus into your heart, the Bible says you'll be like a new person inside. And boys and girls, that's exactly what happened to Ness. Well, it was soon time, or when it was time for him to leave prison, he was a little bit worried because he knew he'd have to go back and apologize to Philemon, and he'd have to tell him that he was a changed young boy, but maybe Philemon wouldn't believe him. So he told Paul, he said, look, I don't know what to do. And Paul wrote him a letter. He said, I know, Philemon. It was me that told your master about the Lord Jesus. And he wrote him a letter, and he gave him a letter, and he signed it. He said, Onesimus is a changed young man. And he told him what had happened, and he signed it. And he said, now you give that to your master, and here you'll be okay. He will forgive you. And boys and girls, Ness said goodbye to all the prisoners. And he went back and he knocked. It was a long journey back. But when he got back to Philemon and Mr. and Mrs. Philemon, he knocked at the door. And they came. And when they saw him, they said, oh, look. And he said, I've got a letter. And boys and girls, they read the letter. And they received him back into the home. And boys and girls, a wonderful story. But I have to stop there because Freddie's going to sing that little song to you. And boys and girls, if you want to read a copy of that letter that Philemon gave, or that Paul gave to Ness all those years ago, Onesimus, you can read it in the Bible. It's found, it's a little book in the Bible. It says the book of Philemon. And that is the letter that Paul wrote in the prison. Now, Freddie's going to sing that song, A New Heart. Also, will I give you, and a new spirit I will put within you. So here he is. Let's get him out of this little box here. Sit up nicely then. Sit up nicely. He's coming. He's so excited. I told him, Freddie, you're coming. I'm so excited.
Oh, wow.
There you go.
Oh, wow. Jesus changed Ness's life.
Jesus changed Ness's life. That's right. And Freddie, whose life can he change?
He can change everyone's life.
What are you going to say? Hello. That's a good boy. And Fred, you're going to sing this little song for me.
Oh, yes. Take away the stony heart and I will give you a heart of flesh. Ezekiel 36, 26. Everybody now a new heart also will I give you. And a new spirit I will put within you. I will take away the stony heart and I will give you a heart of flesh. Ezekiel 36, 26. Hallelujah! Well, a new heart also will I give you. And a new spirit I will put within you. I will take away the stony heart and I will give you a heart of flesh. Ezekiel 36, 26. I'll take away the stony heart and I will give you a heart of flesh. Ezekiel 36, 26.
That's lovely, Freddie. You can find that little verse in the title in the Bible. Freddie, who changed? Who changed Onesimus' life?
The Lord Jesus Christ.
And Freddie, who can he do that for?
Everyone.
Well, what do you have to do?
You have to tell him you're sorry and turn from your sin and ask him to forgive you.
And ask him to forgive you. And if you do that,
he'll fill your heart with his salvation, and you can't get to heaven without it.
You can't get to heaven without it. Well, Freddie, we've got to go.
I was going to see a cuddle now.
Freddie, it's time to say goodbye nicely.
Ta-ta nicely then. See you later.
See you later. Well, boys and girls, thank you. Thank you for joining us today. And we'll see you. We'll see you next time. There you go. Just looking for the little bun to stop the video. Have a great rest of your day.
Wasn't that a thrilling story about Onesimus and all those Nesses that Andy mentioned today? Well, my message is going to follow through on that, perhaps a little bit more adult in its presentation, but nevertheless, it's got the same sentiment in it. What a change Jesus can make in a life. Now, this lovely hymn, or well-known song, by the Collingsworth family, "Since Jesus Came Into My Heart," is a good follow-through from Andy's message today. We rejoice that the Collingsworth family are back on the road again singing after being at home for so long during all the COVID restrictions. But Phil and Kim and the family are traveling again and singing. And what a message they have to sing. After they sing this song, then my Bible reading for today is from 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And I'm going to read from verses 14 to 17, so you can get your Bible ready. Now here is the Bible reading that I've mentioned just before that song by the Collingsworths. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14 to 17. "For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead, and that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Wherefore henceforth know we no man after the flesh. Yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And we trust that God will bless the reading of his word to all our hearts. Now, shall we have a moment of prayer together? Dear Father, thank you today that wherever we are, you know exactly our circumstance and our location. And we thank you today for the grace that is sufficient for every situation that develops in our lives. We thank you that we have a message today for people that can touch their lives and their hearts and change them completely. And we pray that you will make the message a blessing today in the precious name of Jesus our Savior. Amen. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17 says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. The title of my message today might capture your attention. A new you. How about a new you? You say, Pastor Eric, that's just what I need. I need to be made new. Well, praise God, we've got a message for you today. When the Apostle Paul arrived at Corinth, for that's where this letter was written to, the Corinthian church, when he arrived at Corinth, he encountered a culture of corruption. To be called a Corinthian was synonymous with a sinful, hedonistic lifestyle. In actual fact, we get a snapshot of society in Corinth and in that whole region in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 9 to 10. The apostle writes in these words, be not deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor extortioners, shall inherit the kingdom of God. There are 9 categories of evil that are barriers to the kingdom of God. Yet when the Apostle Paul writes this letter, he follows up all that with these words, and such were some of you, but ye are washed, ye are sanctified, ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of God. Now you know why my title is A New You, because that's just how this verse describes people. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. If you want proof of the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ, then you have it right there in those words that I've quoted. Corinth was a choice place to test the message of Jesus Christ, crucified, risen, and exalted. It obviously worked, and it worked powerfully in the face of so much perversion and moral pollution. Paul made a very bold declaration at the beginning of his letter. What did he say? Here's what he said. The preaching of the cross is to those who believe the power of God. Of course, he also did say that it was foolishness to those who were perishing. But the proofs were sufficient to establish the fact that this message had no equal in the philosophies of men. By the time the second epistle reaches Corinth, living proofs are evident in society. People who had been raised in Corinth physically have now been raised in Christ spiritually. They are new creatures in Christ. Now, in the reading that we had, The first verse said, the love of Christ constraineth us. So it was the constraining love of Jesus Christ that brought the Apostle Paul, first of all, to this challenging city environment. We might call it Sin City, Corinth. He knew he had a message that these people needed to hear. And I know today that I have a message that people need to hear. And it doesn't really matter what our background is or what your background is. It doesn't matter how dark or how black or how rebellious it has been. This message, if received in simple childlike faith and with true repentance, can transform your life. There are many parallels between the first century in Corinth and the 21st century culture that we live in our world. The same moral evils not only exist, but are openly flaunted throughout society. The Word of God is denigrated, and those who would stand up to proclaim it are liable to be investigated for hate crimes. I've read about this recently. The battle lines are drawn. They are drawn between right and wrong, between truth and falsehood, between good and evil. But the gospel of redeeming power and the grace of God toward rebellious and lost mankind will go forth, and it will go forth until Jesus comes again for his people. So I've got just a couple of very simple, clear points for you today. First of all, there is the heartbeat of the message. You find that in verses 14 and 15 of the reading. And here's what it says. The love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead, and that he died for all, that they which live should not live unto themselves, but unto him which died and rose again. Two thoughts that come right out of those words. First of all, in verse 14, he died for all. Who are we speaking about? None other than the Son of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, because this was the very heartbeat of the Apostle Paul's message. It was to do with a person. For many years, he had followed a routine and religion, but from that moment on the Damascus Road when he was powerfully converted, he lived for a person, Jesus Christ. The message of the cross also dominated the thinking and preaching of the apostles, and Paul in particular. We find him referring to it again and again throughout his epistles. Calvary's sacrifice was real. Christ's death was real. He did truly die. And he died as your substitute, your ransomer, your redeemer. He was the sacrificial lamb. He carried your sin in his body on the tree, says the Apostle Peter. And by that, of course, he's referring to the cross. The Old Testament prophet Isaiah said, all our iniquity was laid upon him. We read that he died the just for us, the unjust. Why? That he might bring us to God. He died for those who were already spiritually dead. As he says in his letter to the church at Ephesus, people who were dead in trespasses and in sin. Thank God, too, that there are no favorites, no selected specials. He died for all. And again, we read, the same Lord over all is rich unto all, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Oh, praise the Lord. Can I apply that now to you wherever you are? You're not excluded. The only people who are excluded from the benefits of the cross are those who exclude themselves. Calvary's sacrifice was for you, whoever you are, wherever you are, or indeed whatever you have been. Something else that's very powerful and unique to Christianity is that he lives for all. Paul's message didn't conclude with a dead Christ. The symbol of living Christianity is not a crucifix, nor an emblem of a cross around our neck. No, the message of the cross is but the precursor to the resurrection. Because the Apostle Paul's emphasis on the resurrection vibrates throughout his letters. It's present as a historic reality, and that's recorded in the Gospels. But throughout the epistles, it is presented as a dynamic power in every believer. The New Testament benchmark for saved men and women is that they no longer live to themselves, but unto him who is now their living head. And that's what gives the power to live this life. It's Christ in us, not just the hope of glory, but Christ in us, the power to live, to be raised up. As Paul says, we have been raised with him to sit in heavenly places. And he says that in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 6. Not only that, but he says we have been raised with him that we might walk in newness of life in Romans chapter 6 and verse 4. You know, when Andy was telling the story about Onesimus, he said, let's call him Ness. And you remember all those Nesses that were on one side of the board, all the bad Nesses, but then all the good Nesses that were on the other half of the board. We heard about the old Ness that Onesimus was, a runaway slave who had wronged his owner, a good man, Philemon, of course. But then we heard about the new Ness, the Ness that he became. What a change! Because of his meeting with the Apostle Paul and, of course, hearing the gospel and being transformed by the power of God. And later on, when the apostle writes to the church at Colossae, he refers to Onesimus as a faithful and beloved brother. Isn't that lovely? A new Ness, a new you. Yes, even though Onesimus had only been a believer for a short time, he had become a faithful and beloved brother to the Apostle Paul. What an honor that must have been for him to be called such a person. You can become also a faithful and beloved brother of those of us who present Glad Tidings Hour and all those who share in it. You can become part of this great family and you will experience the life of the Lord Jesus Christ in your life. This was the teaching that was given to the Corinthian believers, that the grace of God transforms lives. They had become new creatures or new creations in Christ Jesus. Yes, my dear people, there we have the heartbeat of the message. He died for all. He lives for all. Then there is the heart change through the message. Therefore, that's the opening word of verse 17, signifying what redemption has purchased for us. Therefore, relevant to the risen life of Jesus Christ in us, those two thoughts that I've just been dwelling on in the last few moments, the person we are identified with, if any man be in Christ. It begs the question, are you in Christ? By nature, we are out of Christ. By grace, we are in Christ. And this is the uniqueness of the new birth. It is the life of a person. None other than the Son of God. None less than the Son of God. How wonderful! The Corinthian believers were no longer strangers to the gospel, nor to the one who made it possible. That's why the name Christian is so unique. It signifies Christ's ones, or Christ in you, the assurance, the hope of glory, the person we are identified with. The disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. Yes, they were identified with Jesus Christ. And then the person we are identified as, a new creature or a new creation. Praise God. The New Testament believer in Jesus Christ is not someone who has undergone some kind of cosmetic makeover. It's not the turning over of a new leaf. It's not becoming good living, as some people call it. But it's the evidence of a transformed life because of a transformed heart. Old things are passed away. There's no more desire for the things that we used to do. I do them no more, said the little chorus. It must have been an evident issue in Corinth. These people had to be standout people. I know what it did for me. I know the change that it wrought in me, that it was evident to those who were around me. And it should be and will be for you too. God says, I make all things new. And that includes people whose lives were scarred and soiled by sin. So what's the concluding emphasis? We find it in verse 20. We beseech you, in Christ's stead, or on his behalf, be ye reconciled to God. Would you be reconciled to God through the sacrificial death and the powerful resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ, so that you could be a new you? If any man, put your name in there, if any man be in Christ, or any woman be in Christ, you become a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. I'm reminded of the little chorus. New life in Christ, abundant and free. What glories shine, what joys are mine, what wondrous blessings I see. My past with its sin, the searching and strife, forever gone, there's a bright new dawn, for in Christ I have found new life. Our concluding song today is by Joseph and Sandra Kennaway, singing, Depth of Mercy, Can There Be Mercy Still Reserved for Me? This was a great Charles Wesley hymn, and may the Lord make it a reality in your life. Listen to the words.
Depth of mercy, can there be mercy still reserved for me? Can my God his wrath forbear? May the chief of sinners spare. Shows his words and speaks.
spreads his eyes. God is love, I know I feel. Jesus lives and loves me still. If I rightly read thy heart, if thou all compassion art, Father, hear in mercy.
Thank you for staying tuned with us today. We want you to know that we are praying for you and that God will bless you and be with you. Eric Stewart saying, bye-bye.